The Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
This time I would like to call the meeting to order. Mr. Ashley is going to do our invocation.
And I'm going to ask Pastor Biggers from Lamb's Chapel to have our devotion tonight.
Sure. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, as one of our great presidents said, we want to thank you for this land. Thank you that we have been prospered and blessed, all of us, regardless of your great kindness. And we love our county. We love the way that you've blessed us here. And we want to give you thanksgiving and praise for what you've done. And we pray, as that same president said, apart from your wisdom, unless the Lord builds the house, we labor in vain. We ask for your wisdom and your grace that this might be the best county possible for the people that live here. Thank you for the people who are willing to serve so graciously and those who care enough to be involved. Thank you so much for what you've done. We appreciate your great kindness toward us. Amen.
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 Thank you. Okay, I did have some public comments tonight, so I will start with LaRue Southern, if you would come up to the microphone. And we do limit our public comments to 3 minutes.
My name is LaRue Southern, and I live in the very tip end of Alamance County, which we're working on a new line, I assume. And they found this, they found the line about 4 times, and it's always been wrong. It's wrong again. We don't want to go to Guilford County. We purchased land in Alamance County and built on it, and we're staying. I don't care what the state says. I don't care what Alamance County says, and I certainly don't care what Guilford County says. We're not going to Guilford County. If they want McIntosh, take them. But leave the old people, the elderly, the disabled alone. They built in Alamance County.
Thank you.
And I appreciate your time.
And we
Thank
want
you.
To keep you in Alamance County.
Well, I hope you do.
Chandler, did I get this right? Okay, I'm sorry. Pelthorpe, if you'll come up to the microphone, please, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening. How are you?
I'm Chandler Pelthorpe, and I live in Alamance County at 320 Alamance Street. That's not Guilford Street, it's Alamance Street. And my wife and family and I moved here a year ago to live in Gibsonville in Alamance County, to a house that was built by my wife's family about 100 years ago. And they lived in Alamance County and built it in Alamance County at the time. I found out about all of this when a local TV station showed up at my front door to interview me about how I felt about Guilford County's recent vote to take us. So I was a little surprised. I hadn't received any information or can't by any way say that I was properly informed. And so I have a lot of questions about all this, one of which is, how did this line change get initiated? Who paid for all the surveying? Because that would tell you who's motivated. And why were we not properly and thoroughly informed about all this? You know, I don't know what Guilford County's reasons for, but, you know, do they want to take us because they feel like they can serve us better than y'all can? No, I don't think so. That brings me to questions about schools. We've been transitioning our children from homeschooling to public schooling, and I guess we have our eyes on Highland Elementary, which we know is a really good school. Y'all have done a good job on the schools here in Alamance County, and we'd like to stay here. So on an ending note, I guess I appeal to your integrity and honor, not to just let Guilford County take us because they want to. Would y'all want to live in Guilford County when you could live in Alamance County? So please don't forsake us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Emily Pelthorpe.
Our family wants to continue living in Alamance County. We have three young children, and when we decided to remodel my grandmother's house several years ago, the hope was to be able to send them to Highland Elementary. I understand from state reports and also from friends that I have made since we've been living here that Highland is a great place to have your children in school. So when we were informed by the television crew that the vote had happened in Guilford County and that we would now be at the mercy of the decision between Alamance and Guilford, whether or not we would remain in Alamance, it was rather shocking, and I felt like the cart came before the horse. My husband in the restoration project has put his heart into making our home a restored home, but a beautiful home for our family and for me. He's very appreciative to what Alamance County has, how they have worked with him over and over through, it's been more than 2 years actually, his remodeling effort, but over and over he would come back and say, Alamance County, they were wonderful to work with. I have been building relationships with women my age that have children since we've been living here. My children have been building relationships. We've been here a year, but I would like to be able to continue the community of relationship that we've built with these people that are currently sending their children to Alamance County schools. Our family has a lot to offer Alamance County. I'm a former educator. My husband's already offered so much in his restoration project. So we ask that you continue to keep us, 320 Alamance Street, and the rest of the folks that have a heart to stay in Alamance, please. Thank you.
Okay. Hunt Johnson.
James Hunt Johnson.
Thank you. I have a bit of change of pace for the public comment I'm to make, and it's something very positive. And also, I'd like to talk for a minute about one of the greatest resources we've got here in Alamance County, our people, and more specifically, their work ethic. And those of you who haven't met, I'm Hunt Johnson, the clerk of court for our county. I've been in office since February 2nd of last year. And one of the projects that I was faced with was moving the courthouse, the relocation of the courthouse, which we were able to accomplish at the end of last month with a lot of hard work by a lot of people. It was a cooperative effort among the judges, among the folks at the North Carolina Administrative Office of the Courts, and my employees and the great employees of Alamance County. And I have tremendous praise for them. And there's a stereotype nowadays that we're dealing with as government employees that government employees don't work very hard. They're just there to fill up time on the time clock and leave at 5 and don't really care, and they're not dedicated and they put you off and don't get things done. And I can tell you that we have the exact opposite of that in Alamance County. I have great employees, 43 of them. We're supposed to have 48 and one part-time person by the guidelines for our workload. We've been making do with 41 people, and now with 43 of them, we're state employees. But I was so impressed by the folks who work for the maintenance in Alamance County, and I want to mention them by name, and I hope I don't run out of time or miss anybody. But Richard Hill, the county engineer, was tremendous to work with. He worked and worked and worked with us. We met with him many, many times and developed a plan to move the courthouse, which is quite an undertaking. Franklin Clapp is about the hardest working person you could ever meet in your life. The gentleman was there, and these are salaried employees that are there on a salary, not getting paid any overtime, that were there working. I think Franklin probably worked an 80-hour week. We moved the courthouse. We couldn't shut the courthouse down, and we moved the courthouse at the very last Friday of February, and at 7 a.m., I had my entire staff of 21 folks and their spouses there working for no pay whatsoever. These are people that are state employees that haven't gotten a raise in 2 years. And Franklin was getting paid no overtime whatsoever. Also, I want to mention Tracy Perry, Stephen Scott, and Buddy Weitzel, and how hard they worked. And with the help of Craig and Tim and Richard, we were able to find money in the budget without costing the county any additional funds to pay for most of the sign cost, for the wiring cost, and the moving expenses. We found that in our budget, and we're able to do that efficiently with a lot of hard work and without any extra cost to the Alamance County taxpayers. And I am working on it with Susan Roberts that I think I'm going to be able to cut our budget further. And I found some things that we can cut, and I hope to be back with y'all on that very shortly, that there's some things, some publications we don't need that are available over the internet, and some cuts in some other areas that we can make a little dent in this very tight budget. And I have high praise for the people at the work ethic of folks in Alamance County. Mac Williams is, I'm out of time. I want Mac to be able to write a story about this, to tell businesses that are considering coming here about the work ethic of the people of Alamance County, our greatest resource.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Bentley Devin? Did I pronounce that right?
Owen.
Am I
O-W-E-N.
Close?
Owen.
I'm Bentley Owen, O-W-E-N. O-W-E-N. Okay. I live at 612 Burke Street in Gibsonville, and I also have several properties, or part of properties in Alamance County. I've lived there all my life. One of the biggest problems with this issue was already been stated, that people were not informed that this was happening. Through correspondence with our mayor, who knew very little also, through my trips to Guilford County, where I had a hard time getting maps, explaining exactly how this would affect our properties. You know, this is a time when everybody's talking about budgets, not having money, and here we're spending money on surveys. What's going to happen when we start getting two tax bills? It's going to cost somebody. Keeping up with the confusion of two tax bills. My mother has property that's going to affect her possibly in that way, because I'm still not sure some of the effects of some of the property we have. It's just, you know, it just doesn't make good business sense and good human sense to people that have been Alamance County residents for years. Some of the former properties my brother-in-law was talking about has been in our family for like at least three, if not four generations, and they've always been in Alamance County. How did they come up with this?
Well, I hope Mr. Albright can answer
questions. I would appreciate your support on this. Look at it from the personal, not just the government side, and how many people it's going to affect, not just people right in the Gibsonville area. You know, I really don't know who it's affecting hardly, other than some information I've received from our town.
And we don't either.
And here we are having county governments, Alamance and Guilford, voting on stuff. Y'all don't know.
No, we're not voting.
I know you're not doing it tonight, but I mean, you're faced with that.
No, and we will know before we vote, I promise.
Right.
You.
Now, I hope,
we know.
Right. I hope. Well, I just hope everybody takes all this into consideration.
Mr. Albright is going to address this, okay?
I appreciate that. And I just, you know, at a time when budgets are tight, you know, this is costing somebody some money. And you look at the human aspect, schools, families, and issues, and there's just too many unknown things. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next is Henry Vines. Is Henry in the other building? Henry.
Here he comes.
Yes, how are you?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Yes, Henry Vines, from here in Snow Camp. Also here tonight representing the Farmers and Farm Bureau. As y'all consider tonight the contract for the food processing plant, we sure would appreciate that support that y'all lent to us, and we just wanted to let you know and encourage you to sign that. And I've read over it, and Clyde got the things in there we needed added, and we just appreciate that and just want to let you know our support.
Quick question, Henry. How much volume of produce and stuff do you expect to go over from Alamance to that site?
I'm not real sure of exactly how much they're looking at from Alamance County as far as fruits and vegetables. But, you know, they're looking at a large amount of business there. And I'm hoping that we have a lot of farmers here that sells produce. And, I mean, Jane Isley is one of the, you know, probably one of our biggest producers. And there's a lot of other small producers that will take advantage of that. And there's a lot of people that also do a lot of, you know, jellies and such as that they can use this processing plant to do those. And it's, you know, has the USDA approval and everything. And right. That they, and we're hoping that it'll increase the volume of people that will take advantage of it and maybe want to produce more in a smaller, you know, a smaller amount, because they will have that capability of processing their product. And as you know, and we had talked about, you know, Dan and all, that maybe even in the future that we could maybe even process local food here that could be used in our school system, you know. That's another thing that, you know, that's could be a possible use of it.
Well, I met Mark Danley last week, and we were just talking, and one of the highlights of that is, you know, summer crops are perishable, but people can take and can them and so forth at a place like this and have a product to sell year-round as opposed to two months or 1 month out of the summer.
And as it stands right now, I mean, you know, a lot of people can produce, you can produce stuff, and you can sell all right smart, but a lot of your profit, you'll be lost because it's perishable. But you could take that and have it processed, frozen strawberries or peaches, apples, whatever you may have, and you can sell it, and you've got a way of selling it because you can put that USDA stamp that's certified, where, you know, in the past, you've done it home, you know, there's all kinds of liabilities and everything else with that.
Couldn't even sell.
Right. I mean, and we could, you know, and that's like I said, we're looking at, you know, maybe the possibility of, you know, going to the schools here, you know, and putting some local food in our local schools.
Well, that's great. Exciting.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank y'all.
Okay. At this time, I am going to open a public hearing on the economic development incentives. And if you will want to speak on this, then I will recognize you. And come on, Matt. And this is Matt Williams, and I'm going to let him speak about it, and then we will have the continue the public hearing.
We skipped the sheriff.
I'm sorry.
That's fine. I'm as interested to hear what he has to say as he.
I was checking him off too fast. I didn't mean to skip you. You know
that. I understand that. That is no problem. commissioners, for some time, long before I was grown, there was a jail minister here at the Alamance County Jail. And I would like Ms. Massey to come around. And there's been some key people that was involved in the Alamance County Jail Ministry. And I'm thoroughly convinced that because of that ministry, we have less problems in Alamance County Jail than we do in other jails, because I've done some checking. And there's some key people that has been a part of that. And I would like at this time to ask Pastor Melvin, Pastor Gary Williams, and Pastor Brian Biggers to come up and help me make one of these presentations along with Ms. Massa. Yeah, we're going around there.
Trying to make it feel important, you know.
Yes, sir, I am.
There is a lady here tonight that in excess of 48 years has administered to our inmates at the Alamance County Jail. And I'm not about 50 years old. So I would like to ask Miss Annie Mae Dickey to please come up front. And her family, too. Her family too, that's with her daughter.
On behalf of the sheriff and the Alamance County Commissioners, we congratulate you. And we thank you for all your support to Alamance County. And if y'all have never heard of Platte Piano, you've missed it. She's been playing for how many years?
Since I was about 13. I'll be 93 this month.
Well, you didn't have to tell that. I witnessed it. But thank you again, and congratulations.
Well, thank you, Lord, that I can do it.
And well, we thank you for all you've done for us.
Thank y'all for this. Okay.
Folks, in excess of 48 years. How many of y'all have been at your job for 48 years?
41 or 2 years this past January. Yeah. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome, and you mean so much. And I'm really honest with you, you've touched the lives of many people.
Well, I hope I have.
Well, you have, believe me. I hear the inmates. I go back there a lot, and you mean so much to the Alamance County Sheriff.
In more ways than one, she has
absolutely
touched
Alamance County
people.
Well, I appreciate this so much.
Thank you.
This is quite a surprise. You do that.
And we have one more. Pastor Master Trooper Gary Williams.
I don't know what I knocked off.
I don't know how many of y'all know Master Trooper Williams, but he has been a trooper in Alamance County ever since I was a little boy. he is also a pastor at the First Baptist Church on Apple Street at Burlington. And if you've never heard him preach, you need to go listen. And he is a man of God. He's exemplified that. You know, it's pretty tough to arrest people and then go visit them in jail and try to lead them to the Lord. But this man has done that, and I'd like to read this and let our commissioner, chairman, read it.
Master Trooper G.W. Williams, in appreciation for over 15 years of dedicated service to the Alamance County Jail Christian Ministries, and thank you so much.
You folks are welcome to stay, or you he's out.
And I apologize again, Sheriff Thompson, for overlooking it. Okay, now I'm going to open a public hearing for the economic development incentives. I'm allowed one mistake on it.
Good evening, Madam Chairman, Commissioners. My name is Mac Williams. I'm President of the Chamber of Commerce for Alamance County. And Sheriff, have you ever been told you were hard to follow?
No, sir.
I wish I could videotape and put on a CD what the comments tonight. It's an advertisement for Alamance County with people wanting to stay in Alamance County. It's called the school system, the work ethic of the people, as evidenced by the good work that the folks you recognized are. So this is, I hope we can tape this and send it out because it's telling good stories. And that's part of why we're here. We have a company who's based here in Alamance County, or the parent company that actually is based here in Alamance County. The actual company is called TriVantage. And they have zeroed in on Alamance and at least one other place as a possible location for a facility that they want to build. And part of their decision making will be the extent to which local governments participate in the incentives process. We're here before you tonight. We'll be going to the city of Mebane next Monday night. Here to answer questions about the company is the president of TriVantage, Steve Ellington. And I'm going to introduce Steve to come up and tell you about the company and the project, answer any questions you or the public may have about it before you act. And so I want to comment and compliment Craig Honeycutt. He's been extremely responsive as we've gotten the project to this point. I know that he's been in touch with all of you at some point about some of this. And so to the extent that we are here at this point is a good thing. And I'm excited for the potential of the 35 jobs and the nearly $8 million of investment that this project represents. And so with that, I'm going to introduce Steve Ellington, president of TriVantage, to talk about the project and answer any questions you or the public may have. So Steve, if you want to come up. And also Steve has with him Lee Whitney, who is the vice president for finance and administration for the company. So between the two of them, they'll be able to answer pretty much any question that you have. Welcome. We're glad to have you
here. Thank you, Mac. Appreciate it. Madam Chairman, distinguished commissioners, I'd like to give you a little background about the company TriVantage. It is a wholly owned subsidiary of Glen Raven Incorporated, who has been a company in Alamance County since 1880. The distribution company, which is TriVantage, was acquired 2 years ago in May of 2007. And since that time, we have embarked with an outside consulting group to enable us to be more efficient in how we handle product throughout our 11 locations throughout the U.S. We have two locations in Mexico and one in Canada. Our plans for this facility, which will be in Mebane, would be to handle our, it would be a consolidated distribution site to receive all incoming goods to our distribution center and to fulfill orders to all of our branch locations throughout North America. We hired the Tompkins Group, which is out of Raleigh, to make recommendations on how we could become more of a more efficient company. And the recommendation was that we move ahead with a facility to eliminate a lot of the interbranch shipments that we have, which is basically inefficient in our operation. The decision-making process, as you know, we have plants primarily in North and South Carolina within Glen Raven. Glen Raven has around 2,400 employees. We evaluated the site in Anderson, South Carolina, which is where we have a million square foot facility that we manufacture the Sunbrella outdoor fabrics that you may be familiar with. We looked at the upstate area. We also are evaluating a site in Guilford County. And the reason certainly for the strong, inclination toward the Mebane area is because we are an Alamance-based company. And we would like to have this facility in Alamance County. The site that we're evaluating is a 12-acre site. And we plan to initially construct a facility of 102,000 square feet. We would employ initially 35 employees, five of those which will be management employees. And this is a new business to the area. It is not a situation where we're taking away from existing facilities and putting here. This is a brand new facility. Our thoughts are, if successful, you know, we have between 12 and 13 acres in the site, that we have additional room to add on to this facility in the future. Additionally, in handling the fulfillment of our orders throughout North America, we look also to handle a lot of our export business, which is growing for this business. So the products that would be in the facility would be a lot of the Sunbrella fabrics that you're aware of. And then also 60% of this business is unrelated to Glen Raven products. We distribute products in many cases which are competitive to Glen Raven from this facility. And this will just allow us a more efficient operation. As Max stated earlier, our initial investment is around $8 to $8.2 million. About 4.2 of that will be dedicated to land and building. $3 million will be dedicated to basically the equipment, the racking systems, and all the facility equipment that we need to run the operation. The additional amount will be related to IT infrastructure, services, and other infrastructure that we need to have for the business. So we're very, very excited about, you know, the opportunity. We're very humbled by the discussions that have taken place with the County of Alamance, and certainly we would like your strong consideration for this project.
Okay. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you. And I would certainly, any questions that you may have, happy to entertain those.
Will the employees be full-time or temporary? Or
they'll be full-time. 35 will be full-time, and we look to, and we have a seasonal business to some extent in terms of outdoor fabrics. As you can imagine, when you see the weather such that it is, people get out in their boats and they want shade. And we look at also during season, we'll probably have about 10 additional part-time employees as well to handle the seasonal demand. But, you know, we're certainly basing this on the 35 full-time employees.
Is the land that you're looking at, is it ready for building on? Or
yes, sir. That's
I'm
right.
I'm not real familiar with that.
The site in Mebane, already, other companies there, Becton Dickinson is there. Another furniture company, Ford, is there. We would be next to the Ford company, which they supply the parts to their dealers from that operation.
Nice part. Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I thought I checked on it, and infrastructure's already there, the water,
it
sewer,
is,
and everything.
It is. It's a terrific site.
So that's been done.
Well, we're glad that you're considered Alamance County. We appreciate y'all staying here, and we welcome you with open arms. We're glad to have somebody that's going to supply some jobs.
Thank you. Well, Alamance County's been very good
for over 100 years
now.
And it's been very good to our company. Yes. And, you know, it's certainly a team effort there.
Do I have anybody in the public, in the audience that would like to speak concerning this? This is a public hearing. If you will just tell your name, Mr. Gomery, and...
My name is Bill Gomery. I am privileged to serve as chair of the Alamance Chamber of Commerce, as well as their executive for BB&T and a proud citizen of Alamance County. I come before you tonight just to say a couple of words on behalf of job creation, which is what this request is all about. Certainly, as we look at the current unemployment rate in Alamance County, it being just north of 13%, certainly the worst that I've seen in my short 16-year tenure here in Alamance County may very well be one of the worst that we've ever faced. This is an opportunity for us to invest in new jobs for a company or for the subsidiary of a parent company that has invested 130 years in Alamance County. In my job, I get to work on a lot of non-for-profits, and there's hardly a non-for-profit in this county that hasn't benefited directly from the financial investment of Glen Raven as well as the investment of their people. I can speak to just one project, the New Leaf Society, of which Glen Raven has contributed over the last 2 years almost as much as they're requesting here for this new site. I think that incentives sometimes are considered with a four-letter word. What I'd like to consider that four-letter word to be is jobs. So I request that you grant this request for Glen Raven Tri-Vantage. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gomery. Does anyone else have any comments on this?
$220,000.
Is that right? $220,000.
What's the request?
$205,000.
You can't double dip. I appreciate that, Ann. Thank you, Commissioners. My name is Henry Vines. I come tonight, I want to make a suggestion on this incentive. I know we need the jobs here in Alamance County. But as I read over the contract, I've seen that we give $41,000 on the first year, then $164,000 on the second year. I would like to make a suggestion that if we're going to do this incentive, that we do it in a five-year deal, $41,000 a year, to ensure that our investment is protected, that our that employees are going to stay here, the business is going to stay here. You know, also... in this same deal, the $41,000 is pretty much equivalent to the tax base that we'll collect from this company in, you know, what they're investing. If we don't, we're going to have to take approximately $162,000 out of our 2011 budget to pay these, you know, pay this for the second year. And, you know, with all the cuts that we're asking for and everything, you know, the county commissioner is asking each department to cut and everything, I just think we should consider this. This is an incentive for this company, and it still be there, but it'd be on the basis that they, you know, they do what they say and we'll do what we say. And I'd appreciate y'all looking at that.
Thank you. Any other comments?
I'd like to make one real quick, and I'm not making it as sure. Folks, Glen Raven Mills has been a part of this county for many, many years. My mom worked at Glen Raven Mills and fed me from their pay at Glen Raven Mills. And I would like to see if we can keep jobs here, it will certainly be beneficial, I think, to this county. And I just wanted to say that, and I don't mean to be overstepping my boundaries, but I am a citizen first.
Thank you. Yes, sir, if you'll come up front. Tell everybody your name.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, I'm Tom McGowan. I'm a CPA business person here and also here tonight in my role as Chairman of the Economic Development Committee of the Chamber of Commerce. Thank you for your efforts on behalf of jobs in this county. Thank you for every time these coming up, looking at them, making sure they're properly crafted. These are always difficult decisions from a philosophical standpoint, but they are the way. So many projects, so many communities outside and away from here seem to get involved with outside incentives, and they're the part of the game now. We need jobs. We need investment. The best way to keep revenues up and to keep tax rates down is to get the tax base up. And this is a way of doing it, because if that building doesn't get built, I know what the property, I know enough accounting to know what the property tax is on a building that doesn't exist. It's nothing. And we certainly need investment, and we need jobs and the multiplier effect from that. This is an investment and not an expense. Thank you.
Any other comments?
Oh, can I make a comment?
Yeah, I'm going to make one too. Go ahead.
Oh, anybody else here?
Evidently, it's not any.
I think the term incentive is a hot topic. I don't look at this as an incentive. I look at this as an investment in the future of Alamance County. This is raw land. Is that correct?
It is.
Out there. And the taxes on raw land is a heck of a lot different than it is on a building that's put up out there, especially an investment like you plan to make of $4 million.
$8.2.
No, just on the building, land and building is $4 million. Yes, we do need jobs, badly need jobs. I don't know how we can, it's like a no-brainer. You know, 35 people plus maybe 10 more part-time, but whatever, 35 people being employed full-time, and the ripple effect coming from that just goes out further and further and further, and you're talking about the possibility of expanding too. This is really a no-brainer. This is an investment in the future of Alamance County. It's not an incentive. That's what I want to say to you, and thank you for coming.
And that's basically what I was going to say. I agree with the incentive here. Because investment, Ann said me to call it that. Because, you know, I did check with Craig and to find out, you know, how much the tax would probably be, you know, in years to come. And this is something that we hope is going to be there for a long, long time. Because you've been here how many years now? Over 100. And you've been here all my life, but I'm not 100. But I'm like the sheriff now. And I went to his birthday party that day.
Old, huh?
Yeah, close. But thank you so much. And, you know, I think incentives, everybody says, well, that's, you know, it's a trend and it's here and it is. But I don't look at it that way, because we do get that money back in our taxes. And, you know, if we can't keep jobs here, that's part of our problem, is to keep jobs. And I believe in it. And I think if we don't have incentives at some point, it's going to be more corruption, because people are going to pay people under the table if they want to be somewhere, and we're going to have people that take it, because it's already happened in our state government. They've been in prison for doing the very same thing, whereas if there had been some incentive there instead of them taking a bribe, then that probably wouldn't have happened. So thank you so much, and if it's anything I can do, you let me know. Anybody else got a comment?
I just want to reiterate the same things you guys have said, and also to kind of correct what Henry said, because am I not correct in saying we will not give out this outlay of cash until the investment's on the ground? And
right. The first $41,000 is based on once they build the building and they get the CO, and it does meet that investment criteria. The rest of the money will be once they've paid their initial taxes and then have the 35 jobs. There is a clawback period in here for 2 years. So they have to be, you know, in operation to December 2013. If they're not, then there's clawbacks that is part of the agreement.
Right. And I just wanted to make that point that we are making an investment, and they're making an investment with us too. And I just want to thank them for considering Alamance County and staying here. A lot of companies haven't done that in the past, and thank you for that support to us.
Anybody else?
What I was going to say is the only way we can keep taxes low in this county, and we're in the top 10 for the low tax counties, is to have industry pays a lot more taxes than an individual house. It takes $300,000 home to send one student to school, and look what they're bringing in. $8 million is a lot of incentives, and we appreciate you coming to Alamance County. Investment. That's right, investment.
Any other comments?
Tim. Well, it's time for a no-brainer down here.
I'm sorry.
lack of brain. It's obvious I can't win the debate in this community or this county when it comes to cash incentives. And I'm not trying to debate it tonight at all. You know, I have nothing against Glenn Raven. My father was with Burlington Industries for close to 40-some years. Don't know that they ever asked for incentives, but it was a different time. I'll admit that. But I would say to you that the reason that it is the game that we're in is because we haven't changed the game. There's been no efforts to change it, or not enough momentum to change it. I talked to the County Commissioners Association just the other day, and they said one of the leading persons there, I'm not sure what his name was, so I didn't write it down, but he said, well, we wish the federal government would change it to where the states didn't have to compete with other states. And I think there's not a person that's not sitting up here. I would hope that everybody up here would if we could just cut them off like a light switch to where we didn't have to compete with Guilford, didn't have to compete with Orange, or and that our community was judged upon based on its water, its location, its access to reasonable labor, and so forth and so on. I think everybody would be willing to do that if we could just get everybody else to do it. But I can assure you, nothing in this country takes place when you sit back and say, everybody else is doing it, so we're going to do it too. So, with all due respect, I have to vote no for cash incentives, and that's exactly what it is. It's cash, and it is sad when you sit with a state senator that's fairly well known and fairly well educated, and sit back and discuss with him the fact that cash is actually being given. It's a check, yes, but you can cash it, and a state senator looks at you and says, "Well, I didn't realize that we could do that." That's sad. And I went and had a check brought out and it was shown to him, and he said, well, I didn't realize we could do that. So I don't think the debate's going to end, and so without belaboring it any further, I'll call the question or whatever the motion is.
I have to close public.
Okay. I'm sorry. Go ahead. I'm ready to vote.
Okay. If there are no other comments at this time, I'm going to close the public hearing, and then I will entertain a motion to accept this economic development incentive.
I'll make a move that we do accept this.
I have a motion.
I'll second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Thank you so much. Okay, the next item on our agenda is the proclamation for Alcohol Awareness Month from the Alamance County Youth Advisory Council. We have two young ladies here that are going to come up and tell you about this. And if you'll just tell us your names.
Hi, I'm Jessica Harris.
And I'm Shanice Sellers.
And we are from the Alamance County Youth Advisory Council, also known as ACYAC. And we are a group of teen volunteers from Alamance County that serves as abuse as a voice for the youth on the issues that affect us every day. And we had a choice of the issues that we could choose. And I was the last member there that was present on the day that we chose to do alcohol. We could have done teenage pregnancy, other drug use, and everything like that. But we chose alcohol for the simple fact that we had all been personally affected by underage drinking, whether it was losing a friend through an accident or anything else like that. And we are here today to talk to you about the Talk It Up, Lock It Up incentive, which started about 2 months ago, that we are currently involved in. She was talking weird like that.
And I'm going to read the proclamation. It's talking about Talk It Up, Lock It Up, and alcohol awareness. Whereas April has been designated as Alcohol Awareness Month in North Carolina and Talk It Up, Lock It Up Month in Alamance County. And whereas alcohol kills more kids than all illegal drugs combined. And underage drinking costs the citizens of North Carolina $1.2 billion in medical care, work loss, and pain and suffering associated with the multiple problems resulting from the use of alcohol by youth. And whereas youth who begin drinking before age 15 are 4 times more likely to develop alcohol dependence and are 2.5 times more likely to become abusers of alcohol than those who begin drinking at age 21. And whereas in 2008, 15% of middle school students and 43% of high school students in Alamance County report using alcohol in the past 30 days, and kids get alcohol from there or someone else's home more than from any other source. And parents and other adults need to send and model a consistent, clear message that underage drinking is not acceptable behavior or a rite of passage. And if adults monitor and secure alcohol in their home, they would actively reduce the problem of underage drinking in the community. And whereas partnering with local law enforcement, parents, civic groups, local schools, businesses, elected officers, and other citizens to talk up the problem and raise the community support for the Lock It Up portion of the Talk It Up, Lock It Up campaign are effective ways to reduce your access to alcohol in the home. Now, therefore, the Alamance County Youth Advisory Council requests that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners proclaim April 2010 as Alcohol Awareness and Talk It Up, Lock It Up Month in Alamance County and commend this observation to all citizens.
Thank you. And where do you girls go to school?
Williams. I go to Western Alamance.
Okay.
Any questions or comments?
Weston's a good school. Do you plan to do anything in the schools, maybe for prom? Or I think one good area that you may do this and present a resolution to the PTOs or PTAs in the schools, because you are right.
Yes, we have.
Parents are very much involved in giving their kids alcohol.
Yeah, that's why we did it in April specifically, because prom is May 9th. So we wanted to get it done early. We have the something called Prom Promise, where we have someone, a teenager actually, sign saying that they promise not to use alcohol during prom. And the schools actually have after prom kind of party where they promise that there will be no alcohol, and it's sponsored by the schools. So that's what we're involved in. And we do plan on going to the PTA to ask parents that if they're going to host their kids after prom, that they promise not to use alcohol. And we have.
Do you not have something, too, that you're going to have some kind of
pledge cards, actually, that we don't have with us that parents can sign?
I got something in the mail from it or something.
Yes, we distribute pledge cards throughout Alamance County in the mail.
Okay, I did get something.
Adults can promise. And we have websites and things like that you can sign up on.
And to let you know that April is Abuse Month.
Yes, that's what we're here.
I think that's great.
Any more questions?
Underage, under 21.
Any more questions?
I would like to say to you, I do driver's ed basically over in Guilford County. And it's tragic to see the sites where young people have ended their lives on a split second at a tree site. You know, 16-year-old girl from Page died up on 150 near Summerfield. Did you hear about the two girls and the guy that died at Brown Summit? The boy was 23, the two girls were 19, the girl driving was 20. And I took two sets of students out to that site and stopped and rolled the window down and looked at the pictures, the teddy bears, the ribbons. And what's scary, and maybe a young person can explain this to me, maybe I was reading their emotions wrong, but when they looked at it, they just acted like it was no big deal. And it was just ripping me apart to think that those beautiful people died at that site. It was a 40-mile-an-hour curve, and they said the girl was driving 85 to 90. And the car split in half, and you could still see pieces of the car all around the site a week or two after. And it's just tragic what's happening. I don't know if it's, if young people are, what do you feel? Do you feel like they're shocked when they see these things, or is it just common day occurrence now, or how do you feel?
I really think that it really doesn't hit home until, like, it's somebody close to you.
Okay.
I know at my previous school that I was attending, I was in middle school at the time, there was this boy who was killed because the driver was, you know, he was racing, actually, and he was, I've also heard that he was, you know, under the influence. And, like, when that happened, like, that hit home to pretty much 6th, 7th, and 8th graders at the school at that time. Everybody was like, oh, my gosh, because everybody knew him. And when he died, it was just that Monday at school, it was just everybody was just quiet. Mm-hmm. So I don't really think, you know, it's pretty much if they don't know the person, to them, to some people, actually, it's just like, well, I didn't know him, so I don't care, you know.
Yeah, I see
it. It's also the thought of it could never happen to me. That's what they always think. They think I'm being careful, like I'm not that drunk, like it matters somehow. And the thing of it is that we can, I think there's actually a rule that it's only one shot. Even if you're fully grown, it's one shot for girl and then two shots for guys, and you have to wait an hour before you're considered it's not in your system anymore. And they think that I'll eat a lot or something like that, and I'm fine. But it's not true, and their mind says that it could never happen to me. I'm so careful, but it's just not true.
Well, we thank you for your input in this, and we're certainly glad that we got some youth that understand this situation. So at this time, I will entertain a motion to accept this proclamation.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed.
And thank you for your efforts.
I do have this signed and ready for you to take with you. So we've all signed this for you. So I'll present that to you now. Okay?
And thanks for your hard work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your work. Okay. Next is the probation and parole facility request, Tim Burgess.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. As you're aware, this January the 1st of this current year, the county became responsible for all of the facility costs for probation and parole. Prior to January the 1st, the county was paying approximately half of the cost to lease office space for probation and parole. Due to the act of the legislature, they changed that where the county is entirely responsible for it. In this current budget year, we're paying, or I guess this upcoming budget year, $137,348 to lease space for probation and paroles. We have some concern about actually leasing space for something that the county is responsible for, so we just started looking into, okay, how can we change that process? And what we looked at is some alternatives to actually having county-owned space that we could put probation and paroles in. We don't have any space available for them, so we looked at what would it cost to actually construct some space to actually be able to house them. Currently, they're in two different facilities. We'd like to get them under one roof. The least expensive way to do this would actually be doing a modular unit, and I'll show you one in just a minute, kind of give you an idea of what that might look like. The facility that we need, and this is some preliminary numbers, but it looks like about 10,000 square feet. We would need about an acre and a half to 3 acres of land to be able to put this modular site on. The $137,000 that we're paying in the lease payments, part of that goes to utilities, so we would actually have about $120,000 left over that we could actually use toward debt payments. So what we would hope to do is to be able to borrow the money, get the modular unit constructed, put on the site, do all of the grading work, including the parking lot, then be able to use the $120,000 to make debt payment, which would carry us out several years down the road. It could be 8 to 10 years. But once that debt's paid off, then that money's freed up to be used for other budgetary purposes. So that's what we're looking at doing. I do want to show you a facility that we actually visited. This is Stokes County School has purchased two of these facilities to actually use for temporary housing for elementary school. It does have an institutional look to it. And you can do things that would cause it to look less institutional, but this large facility is still going to look institutional. That's just the nature of it. Unlike what we're trying to do up at Pleasant Grove, which is a smaller unit that we can make look less institutional. This is just the exterior view of it. This building right here has 7 classrooms in it, and it has a section for office space for the principal and some other things. That's just an exterior view of it. This is one of the entrances, and this is a aluminum ramp that they have, which is what we're looking at actually putting up at Pleasant Grove, possibly. These things will last a long time. You don't have to worry about splinters or anything like that. So it's very, very good. Just a side view of it with the air conditioning units that are actually mounted on the side. Another, at the other end of the building, the other ramp structure that they have. This is just an exterior view of it, just a view of the gutter system and the roof. This is a view when you get inside of the facility. Let me back up for just a second. The exterior view here, that is actually 29-gauge steel on the exterior, so it is very durable. This facility here will probably last 30-plus years, if not longer, before you really have to put any money into it. This is a view inside, just looking down the hallway. You have classrooms on the right and the left. This is the library that's in there. Another view of the library. View of the library. This is the computer lab. It's a view of it. We couldn't actually take pictures of the classrooms because the kids were in there at the time, so we didn't want to do that. But the rooms are basically set up where they have a projector system in it, as this one does, in the ceiling. And has a whiteboard on the wall, and then also has a screen. Actually, they were using smart boards in these rooms, actually, instead of projectors and screens. They're using smart boards. Restroom facilities, and these are the way these are designed is you can actually just take a water hose in there and wash down the whole room. It's got a floor drain in the very middle, so they're very easy to keep clean. So that's just a quick view of that. The nice thing about that facility is about 9,300 square feet. They paid $330,497 for that unit, which comes to be about $35 a square foot. So they're very economical versus if you were to do construction, typical construction for that for a commercial grade facility, you're looking at, you know, it could be as much as $125 a square foot. So very economical to be able to do that. And I've also left a copy of the company's website that did that building. Now, what we would do is actually, if we get to this point, we would actually put this out for bid. So we would send it out to multiple companies to bid on it. But there is you do have the company's website if you want to go in there and view that. What we're looking for tonight is we're looking for the board to approve a contract with Allie Williams, Carmen, and King, which is a local architects, engineering, and landscaping firm here in Alamance County, for them to evaluate up to four sites for us where we could actually locate this modular unit. They'll take four different locations. Once we find those locations, they'll look at those things. And in the proposal that you have before you, it does list the three things that they'll do. And just let me run through that very quickly. First thing they'll do is provide a preliminary site layout showing approximate location for a 10,000 square foot building with associated parking. Second thing, they'll provide an estimate of cost for the site grading, paving, water, sewer, storm, and stormwater management. They'll also provide a summary of other issues that may affect site development, such as zoning requirements for possible environmental concerns. And then following their analysis of each site, they'll provide a summary ranking the sites and also giving a recommendation as to which site the county might choose to go with. The contract for them would be somewhere between $4,000 and $5,000. They'll actually, I think, bill us on an hourly basis for their work on that. That would be the first step. We're hoping that will be completed in 45 days, that we might be able to come back at the second meeting in May. And at that time, we would want the board to select a site to place that modular unit and also to enter into a second contract with Allie Williams, Carmen, and King to do the site engineering for the project, to also do the building design for this modular unit and to assist us with bidding and negotiating the purchasing of the modular unit for this. And then that we would come back hopefully in the second meeting in May and to be able to do that. And I do have Daryl Russell, which is a principal engineer with Allie Williams, Carmen, and King here tonight if you have any engineering questions for him, so, or more technical questions.
Do you have a cost on this?
Yes, $24,000 and $5,000. That's just for the site analysis. That's right, the proposed site analysis. And that would be the initial part. And then we would bring back the second contract again at some, hopefully at the second meeting in May.
Any questions?
Is there a certain area of the town, county that we need to look at? I mean,
we're trying to stay within a couple of miles of the courthouse here.
Okay, so you need something maybe in the Graham ETJ type.
Yes. Graham. And so we're trying to stay, within 2 miles. One of the sites we're looking at is, it's probably 2.5 miles, which is close enough. Because right now the probation and parole, they have an office in downtown Burlington. and then they have an office out near our EMS center out there. So that's where their two existing locations are. So,
now we would consolidate both of those into one building.
One facility, and then also be able to try to get them where they're a little bit closer than the Burlington, but it may could possibly be a little bit further than their existing site over by the EMS center.
And this is the mandatory thing that the state issues?
This is mandatory, and yeah, because we're paying now almost over $137,000 in lease payments, and it's just it's going towards lease.
I mean, in the long term, yes.
So what's the total cost of this?
Don't know at this point. I mean, I can give you an estimate that, and this is just strictly an estimate. We haven't. I would say that a million would be probably the most. That when you look at actually the grading of the site, the parking lot, looking at purchasing the facility, looking at furnishing the facility, and all that, we would hope to be able to stay under $1 million. And so the payback on that would be, you know, somewhere 10 to 11 years probably. Once that's, and it wouldn't cost us anything additional than what we're paying now, because we would be using $120,000 approximately of the lease payments to pay the debt payment with. So it wouldn't be costing us anything more than what we're currently budgeting.
Good return.
Are there any issues with this type of structure?
That's one of the things that they're going to be looking at. One of the sites that we've preliminary looked at, there's no zoning issues there, but that's something they will be looking at, the different sites that we find. They'll be addressing those issues to make sure there are no zoning issues.
Mr. Russell, if you will stand up. I'm not sure everybody knows you.
Well,
I know you. This is
everybody knows
this
him.
Is Darryl Russell, in case everybody doesn't know who he is. Okay. Do you have any comments?
He's covered it well.
Thank you. Okay.
So what would be our next step here?
Tonight would be to approve the initial contract that's laid out in the proposal that you have before you, which would be, again, for them to evaluate 3 to 4 sites at an estimated cost between $4,000 and $5,000. And that's all that we would be committing to at that point. They'll come back again, hopefully second meeting in May, do a presentation to the board, ranking the sites, and with a recommendation as to maybe which one the board may choose to go with. Then at that point, we'd get into the second part of this process.
Do I hear a motion?
I'll make that motion that we
have motion on the floor.
Forward.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
I own the.
You own the first one?
I'm on the first one.
Okay.
We'll slow down.
Okay. Thank you. That passes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Mr. Bird. Okay. Next is the grant application for the sewer line extension, and Mr. Honeycutt is going to talk about that.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In working with the Chamber and the City of Mebane, and also again with Darryl Russell with Allen Williams Carmen King, we've identified an opportunity with EDA to look at some sewer grant funding. It would be at North Carolina Industrial Park over in Mebane. This is a program that is a 95% grant opportunity with a 5% match, and we're looking at the possibility of using the sewer line easements as our match, so there is really no cost to the county. The county qualifies for the grant program. The City of Mebane does not, and that is one of the reasons why we've been asked to apply for this grant. Again, we talked about, you know, earlier about infrastructure. This hopefully would open up over 400 acres of the North Carolina Industrial Park that is currently unsewered to make sure that they would have sewer. So this would give us a very good leg up in hopefully some future industrial development as well. And Darryl said as well.
Darryl, you got any comments on that?
This is just one of the best programs I've seen in a while. I haven't seen a 95% grant in a long time. So we've been talking about economic development tonight. And I think this is one more possibility of helping that.
Somewhere in this paperwork I read where that 5% would be.
Right, it would be the donated cost. Sewer easement.
Yeah, okay. Exactly. It's not going to be additional cost right. Coming.
It's an in-kind.
It's an in-kind.
Right. Exactly.
Okay.
I thought I read that somewhere in here.
Well, then you got to give them cash to come into the
park. I can't win.
Is that can't if win. You build it, they will come. Okay. Tim, that's it. If you build it, they will come. Okay.
I hope they will.
If you build it, they'll come ask for the cash.
Well, I hope we make it illegal. So until we do, we'll keep it.
Okay. Do I hear a motion that we accept this
grant? Second.
The application for the sewer line extension. I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed.
All right, got that one.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Okay, next is Mr. Albright. It's your turn.
Oh, boy.
The Guilford County line discussion.
The March 18th meeting of the Guilford County Commissioners. You want me to come up?
Yes, we want to address the board, please.
March 18th meeting of the Guilford County Commissioners, they took up the resolution to do four things. They want to ask the North Carolina General Assembly to ratify the 2008 North Carolina Geodetic Survey, which the state of North Carolina paid for. Didn't cost the county anything. Now, this was based on a 2007 resolution that this board passed and Guilford passed and Orange passed, asking the Geodetic Survey to find the Guilford County line and the Orange County line with Alamance. So that's the first thing they adopted in their resolution. The second thing was the enabling legislation that gives this board, or gives their board, a toolbox to address issues affecting landowners. And those issues are schools and tax value and whether or not a piece of property should even be moved into a county based on a number of reasons. We've discussed these reasons with Orange County, and we've come up with what we think is a good plan with Orange to address some of these issues that the neighbors in Mebane and that part of the county have brought to our attention. The third thing in their resolution, they want to direct their staff to work with Alamance County staff to adopt measures to ensure that any adverse impacts to landowners are minimized and that no essential services are affected, such as fire and public safety, EMS. Right now, there's duplication of services. If you get a EMS call and we don't know where the line is, two ambulances show up. It's very wasteful. The fourth part of their resolution was providing notice and opportunity for all affected landowners to provide input to the two staffs on these issues. So what we've done is similar to what we're doing in Orange County. I have developed with my counterparts in Orange and in Guilford a local bill that gives Alamance County Board and Guilford and Orange the power and authority to do a number of things that you can't do now as commissioners. The first is, excuse me, our clerk of court will be happy to hear this, all public records that are filed in the county can remain in that county. If the line moves, doesn't matter. The local bill will, you don't have to go and refile your deed or refile your divorce papers or any of those good things. Property tax issues. If there is an issue on valuation, as there will be, because we have 52 cents, Orange is what, 98?
99.
Over
68?
They went down.
Oh, did
something.
The variances and differences can be adjusted between the two tax administrators. And if they can't agree, the local legislation says if there's a dispute, then the two counties share the cost of paying to hire an attorney to go down to Raleigh and straighten it out with the Department of Revenue. That covers the tax value disputes. But what I want to make sure everybody understands is Guilford County adopted the line. They adopted the survey, which is what they asked the geodetic folks to do. They said, lay out the line. So they found it. They said, here it is. And Guilford County says, all right, here's the line. Second part of our resolution, we're going to ask you to go down to Raleigh with our Guilford delegation and pass this local bill to give us the tools to work out the transition issues, the school board issues, the board of election issues, the jury pool issues. They even addressed, as we do, what court district changes might take effect. So I think at this point, what Guilford has done is what essentially I've recommended this board do in Orange and in Guilford. Recognize the survey, pass this or some form of this bill in the short session of the General Assembly that gives the board the power and authority to make these transitional changes, and it also protects the board because we've got to list taxes now come January 1 in the county where the state says the line is. Now, I want everybody here to remember the state of North Carolina picks out where the line is. I don't.
They picked it wrong 3 times.
Well,
you're not allowed to do that.
The state of North Carolina decides where the line is. The geodetic survey folks are a branch of Diener. And they did exactly what all three boards asked them to do. They found a line. I think the fair thing to do, and I think this board has instructed me to do this, is to come up with a way to transition these things so nobody gets hurt. And that's what we're going to try to do with this legislation. And I've talked to the Guilford County attorney. He's ready, willing, and able to work with us. Our staff's going to work well with them, I think. We're working well. We've got a good relationship with the Orange County staff. So I think we can get this done.
Well, I do have a problem that they didn't invite us, and we did not get to go ride and look at where the line
right.
was.
We didn't
I have notify. A problem with that.
I got a lady.
You know, we rode all day one day in Orange County, and we stopped at every place that the geodetic showed us where the little silver... things. And we didn't even know this was going on.
Well, I got a late invitation to the meeting. The county attorney asked me to come and sit and answer any questions, which I was glad to do. But I'm sure we can ride down the line if we need to. Because if we do this and get this bag of tools from all three counties, surely we can figure out a way to transition these people so they don't get hurt.
Well, and you know, and the people didn't have a chance for this either, and that's what really bothers me.
I've got a question. I mean,
well, the fourth part of the resolution
had in that county for 100 years.
That's right.
Have we been that messed up for 100 years?
Yes.
Well, yeah, just
actually,
like Orange was 100
actually there years. Are several good cases in Guilford County. One of them involves a chicken house.
I know that case very well.
Where the court threw it out. Guilford County was trying to collect taxes on a chicken house.
And I've been to that chicken house. I've seen that marker.
Yeah, they couldn't figure out where the line was. This does it. The way they used to do these county lines was, Guilford was 1771 when it was carved out of Orange. And then Alamance, 1849. I think we were one of the few counties that actually had a survey. And our survey proved to be pretty darn accurate. Not off by much. But over time, when the farming communities transitioned into neighborhoods, and malls, and these type of things, the lines got blurred. The tax people, I'm going to blame it all on the tax assessor. They're the ones that kept moving the lines and making deals. And when it comes down to collecting taxes, it's hard to do, unless you know where the line is. But I think Guilford didn't change the line. They just recognize the geodetic survey line. They're going to ask the General Assembly to give them a bag of tools to transition with us. And the fourth thing they asked was provide notice and opportunity for all affected landowners to be heard. So this isn't a cram it down your throat thing. This is just another step in a long road. I've been on this path for going on 4 years now. Some people longer, but it's been a long process, and I think we're getting close to the end.
And Madam Chair, if I can say that one of the things that we tried to do is just share information, because we knew we were going to have very similar issues with the Guilford County line that we have with the Orange County line. The issue is that the Guilford County people, instead of trying to meet and say, we need to go over this, they basically said, we like it. We're going to go ahead and approve it. And again, as Clyde said, if he wasn't notified a day or two before the meeting, he would not even have been there. So, our staffs, at least since I've been here, have not sat down with the Guilford County staff and gone over any process. And if I'm hearing the Gibsonville people correctly, is they're more concerned over process right now and being left out in the cold than they are anything else. and I do want to apologize to you about that. That was not the intent of this staff. It was not the intent of the board to put you in that position so you could not be heard. They basically took the item and ran with it. Now we need to basically pull back the reins just a hair to make sure that everybody is on that same page and that everybody is as well informed as they can be.
But I would suggest that while we're all agreeable as far as attorneys go, that we get some direction from you so we can proceed to get this local legislation to give this board and the Orange Board and the Guilford Board the tools that they need to adjust these lines. Because right now, we don't have these tools. This is this legislation doesn't last forever. As soon as the line is formulated, then you don't have that.
So basically, we're going to try to do the same thing that we're going to do in Orange County.
Yes, ma'am.
The people that are on the line will still stay where they are or whatever.
We've come up with a buffer, a strip. It's about 150 feet wide along the line. Okay. And we're working on the criteria with the Orange County staff now. I would suggest we do the same thing with the folks in Gibsonville. Okay. If their home is within 150 feet of this newly located line, then we can work out the transition on that.
And I'm going to let Mr. Williams speak, too. Sure.
Well, I'd like to just say one little thing about this is the fact that I think that what we can do as a board is at least present this and show where the people that are here tonight are coming from as to their relationship to the line. We did it in Orange County, which was really informational to everybody.
Well, it's a good point you make because when we had our first meetings in Mebane and at Hebron Church, we sent out letters to 500 or 600 people, and many of them weren't even near the line, wouldn't be affected by it. So I would suggest that we sit down with these folks that are within that buffer area and sit them down and just show them where the line is. That some of them may not even be affected by it.
Well, you know, just the visual presentation that we had with the GIS was really informational and marking what was going on as to where it was, where the proposed line is, and so forth.
We can certainly do that.
Well, that's it. We haven't seen it.
I don't think we're ready to do whatever until we look at it anyway.
Right.
Sure.
Okay, I'm going to let Mr. Williams talk. This is Lenny Williams. He is the mayor of Gibsonville. Mr. Williams.
Thank you, Madam Chair, for allowing me to speak tonight. Bill, this isn't propaganda. This is real stuff. Gibsonville left out of the loop. This is real stuff, and we don't like it.
Quote the source of that, Lenny, by the way.
The Rhinoceros Times.
Well, I've never heard of Rhinoceros Times.
It's a newspaper in Greenland.
It's a good one, yeah.
It's a newspaper you can believe in what they tell you.
Exactly.
Brother Hammer.
Very conservative newspaper that I read and I like. Good evening, Madam Chair and members of the Board of Commissioners. Again, thank you for allowing me to speak tonight. About 2 weeks ago, I spoke before the Guilford County Commission, and I thought I walked into a lion's den. And it's good to be here where we have a little bit of civility, and we thank you for your kindness. Madam Chair, our board was scheduled to meet tonight, but we felt so strongly about this issue that we postponed our meeting until tomorrow night. And some of our board members are here tonight. I would just ask them to stand, the board members that are here. Mrs. Revels and Mr. Shepherd and Mrs. Moulton was here. And I would just ask the people from Gibsonville, even knowing that you weren't going to act on it, a few of them came out tonight, I'd just like to ask them to raise their hand so you know who you're here from Gibsonville.
And we thank you for coming today. We're in the dark, too.
Madam Chair, I have been attending the Orange and Alamance County meetings. I've attended most of them because I wanted to keep abreast of what was going on, because I figured what would happen over there would probably happen to Gibsonville. And not one time did I hear a word said about the Guilford Alamance County line. No matter what your attorney said, this has been rammed down our throats by the Guilford County Commissioners. And we just don't think it's fair. On March the 17th, as I was riding around town, I saw Channel 8 was in town, broadcasting from Gibsonville. So I asked the manager to try to find out what that was about. And when he called around, he found out they were interviewing people about the county line. Not one citizen in Gibsonville had been told about it. Not one elected official had been told about it. So I watched the channel, the news at 5 o'clock. And on the news, they said Guilford County was going to vote on the county line tomorrow night. Not one citizen had been told about it. I attended that meeting, not with the intention of speaking, because normally Guilford County don't let you speak on something on the agenda. They have their minds made up. But they did allow me to speak. And I want to say to you, it was not fair at all. No consideration was given to the citizens of Gibsonville. And I want to say to that Mr. Honeycutt has got us the information that we have. Before that, we didn't even know what streets were affected. Now we do have a map that shows the houses. And I would like to say to the attorneys who worked this out, you have the purple little dot on it for the houses that's going to go into Guilford County. You have the green for the ones going to stay in Alamance County, and the yellow ones that's in question. Well, you forgot about the house, what's inside the house. There are people inside those houses. There are children inside of those houses. And when you move from one county to the other, if you move from Alamance County to Guilford County, you immediately have a 21.74 in tax increase. The tax rate in Guilford County is 73.74. Alamance County is 52. So you're moving these folks to a higher tax area, and not one has been told about it, not even one elected official. And I wouldn't mind if you didn't tell the elected official, but the property owner should know about it.
I hadn't seen that map with those dots on it.
We have the draft maps, and again, we've not had the workshop with the board. That's
right. We haven't had a workshop, but we will have one.
Madam Chair, I have spoken to some of the General Assembly delegations. They cannot believe that Guilford County is asking them to vote on something when the people have not been heard. And when I spoke to them on Friday, I told them that I had planned to be here tonight, and I didn't believe that this board would act without hearing the voice of the people. So I'm asking you tonight not to act on this resolution tonight or any time until the people have been heard, and I believe that you will not do that. The Guilford County Attorney, Mr. Payne, and Mr. Albright recommended that the Guilford County Board of Commissioners adopt that resolution, even though the property owners had not been heard. I was there. They recommended strongly that it be approved. And it was approved by a 9-1 vote. This does not seem to me like it was governed by the people, for the people. But it seemed like to me governed by two attorneys without considering the people and making this decision. And when I stand here and say that here's a resolution that the county commissioners of Guilford County is telling me that was sent over by you, and you don't know anything about it, there's something wrong with that picture. In closing,
we had a problem, Mr. Williams, but we didn't know that this was going at this time.
Mr. Albright was quoted in the newspaper, and I have a copy of it here, that we have a similar problem in Alamance County, Orange County, and it should be resolved soon, he said. He said that line will not be straight. He said that some areas will be carved out. I'm here to tell you that I want the same, or we want the same, the residents of Gibsonville want the same for the town of Gibsonville. Commissioner Gibson was quoted in the newspaper Sunday before last that the Guilford County commissioners have been hijacked by Commissioner Austin and Commissioner Steve Arnold and the county manager. I don't know if that's true or not, but what I'm saying to you, don't let them hijack you. Stand up for the people that's been loyal to this county, and you've heard from the citizens that's been there for a long, long time, much longer than I have. They love this county. They work hard for this county. They want to stay in this county. And I would ask you to follow the same and leave them in the county. Thank you.
Craig, what do we do now? I think we need to have a meeting of the minds with these people and at some point. So you and Mr. Albright can...
Probably a very similar process of what we've done with Orange County up to this point.
Before we adopt anything, I think.
I would suggest that we work together with our staffs like we have with our Orange staff. We've about got the local legislation at a point where I think all three county staffs agree on it.
I want to see it, though, in front of me.
Right. Well, the local, we can show you the map, but we need to meet with
not tonight, but I want to see this.
In Guilford.
At a different meeting.
And address some of these valuation issues. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. But we're under a little time constraint here because the geodetic survey folks, the state of North Carolina General Assembly is the only one that can lay out a county line. And they've done that. So that's why I've suggested this enabling legislation. It gives us some breathing room to address these landowners' issues and provide notice and opportunity for all of them to be heard, like we're doing in Mebane and in Orange. And when we get it all done and get the map resolved, then we can go down to Raleigh and ask them to approve the line.
Well, I think that what they want to do is meet with us, though, first. Is that not right?
That's exactly right. And I would like to say that I have spoken to some members of the General Assembly, and they have told me that they will not bring this down until we've heard.
Okay.
We've been heard.
Right. And it needs to be that way.
Okay, so we just need to set up a joint meeting at some point.
We can set up a joint meeting, and probably it would be more of an informational type meeting with staffs. You know, board members would be invited as well, but it would not be a quote-unquote joint board workshop. It should be more of an informational type meeting.
Okay.
You know, we had a couple of those in Orange County.
We did.
On the Orange County issues. So that's probably the first step is for us to get with their staff, come up with a date and a time and a location, work with Ben as well, their town manager, and try to come up with a location and get out those notices.
Okay.
Have you got a location, Mayor, that we could use in your fine town?
Certainly,
we'll
get you one.
That's a little restaurant down there that would be a good place.
We can't pay enough for that.
Well, at this point, we're not here to vote tonight anyway. So we will get with you and work with you guys and get some more information because I'd like some more information. I think my board would like some more information.
One quick question. This enabling legislation allow for grandfathering in? Is that one of the tools?
That's one of the tools we're talking about, along with the school issue. If you're living in a house and you've got young children there and you want them to continue in Alamance County Schools, you can continue as long as you own your home and have young children that want to go to school.
Which is the same scenario we're using in Orange. But I still think we need to have this meeting first so everybody will know what they can do or what's going to happen.
What's being proposed.
Yeah, what's being proposed, okay? So, Mr. Honeycutt, if you will get that.
We will get that and hopefully have a date in the next 4 or 5 days.
That's fine.
We'll let you know.
That okay?
Well, Mayor, we thank you for coming and avoiding your meeting tonight for tomorrow night. I certainly thank all these folks from Gibsonville area to be here tonight. It means a lot to us because we were taken by surprise almost as badly as you were taken by surprise. And I say that because you have homes and so forth. And that was something that should not have happened. I'm sorry. I agree with Mayor Lenny Williams that it's supposed to be a government of, by, and for the people. And not certain
you want us at your meeting tomorrow night.
You
want me to come to your meeting tomorrow
night? 7-11, anytime you want to come.
Thank you. Okay.
I'll put you on first.
Okay. I have a question for Mr. Honeycutt. I'm one of those people whose house is split by this new line, and I was curious, what is the provision, or what are they thinking of for people if your house is split? How do they deal with that?
Well, I think we'll talk about that at the meeting, because this is not up for discussion tonight, okay? So we will work it out, and all the questions you can answer. Ask every question.
And feel free to call them tomorrow, and they can answer that, too.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, next is Mr.
Me again.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about prayer.
Yeah.
Talking about prayer. Which we are going to continue to have.
The Federal District Court last
recently ruled for Scythe County was violating the United States Constitution by allowing prayer with sectarian references at the Board of County Commissioner meetings. And this lawsuit prompted me to start thinking about a policy. And other counties and other cities have also been prompted to come up with some type of written policy. So I have studied the cases, the Marsh versus Chambers case, U.S. Supreme Court cases, the Fourth Circuit case of Simpson versus Chesterfield County. And based on those rulings from the Supreme Court and the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals, I've prepared a policy regarding opening invocations before meetings to Alamance County Board of Commissioners. And the key in all of these cases that I have read is that the board needs to adopt a policy that doesn't proselytize or advance any one particular faith. And I would suggest having at the beginning of the meeting, before we open the business portion of the meeting, to have our invocation. That way it's not government doing it, it's an individual for the benefit of the legislative body itself. And just need to make that clear that we're not affiliated with any specific, one specific faith. And that's the summation of this. And I did put in here the Pledge of Allegiance, and I guess I slipped up on that, but that's what we did in Greensboro. We always had the Pledge of Allegiance before the meeting. You may want to take that out. You may want to leave it in. I'd be happy to try and answer any questions you may have.
I'd like to make a comment.
One or the other, though, is kind of what you're saying.
Well, you asking for a motion? Or
No.
What is your pleasure as far as moving this in? The Pledge of Allegiance.
Yeah, the Pledge of Allegiance.
I'd like to see us do that.
Okay. What?
Well, I compare this with what we did or do in schools before the Supreme Court decides to get really ridiculous and say we can't do it at all. I know when I was still there, I could not leave the students in prayer, but I could turn around and say, okay, today's your day, and on the second, it's your turn, and on the third, it's your turn, and let a student do that. That way the administration, quote unquote, is not leading a prayer. I personally like inviting a minister, a preacher, to our commissioners' meetings because I like for the community to be involved. And that's not government leading or giving out a prayer. And I think that may be a problem down the road if we're not careful.
Well, the Supreme Court and the Fourth Circuit have put this in terms of a legislative invocation as opposed to a school invocation. And I know when I was a young fella in school, we used to open up with prayer every morning until that ruling from the Supreme Court. But I can testify personally that as long as there are final exams, there will be prayer in school.
You got it.
So, but as far as our meetings go, our governmental body and the legislative invocations, if we do that before the meeting and don't invoke or proselytize, that's a hard word for me to say, a specific or particular faith, I think we'll be fine. The Supreme Court has so ruled. So it's for the benefit of the body. That's why we're doing it. The Congress does. Congress of the United States does.
I have no problem.
So
let me ask you a couple questions here. Number one, it seems like this is being precipitated by the Winston-Salem deal, Forsyth County. Mm-hmm. Over there, their county commissioners were being sued by the ACLU. ACLU was representing a group that had in their title separation of church and state, blah, 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 blah. Well, number one, that has never been in the Constitution. That was in a letter from Thomas Jefferson to somebody else. That's where that phrase came about. I can't imagine that we've all of a sudden gotten excited about this, especially with an appeal process that's being heard over there. You know, to me, it would have been wiser not to put this on a radar screen for it to hit AP Press, which has already hit. It's already, you know, I saw it in Greensboro News and Record. It's on the AP Wire Service now. I mean, now we're a target, possibly, you know, that we're doing something here. I would have thought it would have been wiser to have been just until the sleeping dog wakes up, don't kick it. And so, number one, I can't imagine that we've done anything here and gotten it on the radar screen with an appeal pending over there in Forsyth. Okay. Number two, you mentioned in the policy that consecutive commissioners, I mean, we can't have a prayer, an invocation in consecutive meetings. Now, define that.
That's the policy, the way it, I meant to state that, there's no one board member at each meeting offers the prayer. It rotates.
Kind of like what we're doing now.
Right.
Well, we do it twice a month.
We do it twice a month.
So that would still be okay.
That would be fine.
Because I could consecutive as meaning one Monday and then well, 2 weeks too. Later. Next Monday. Now, over in Forsyth County, part of the debate was, I think, Jesus' name was being referenced. Okay. Are you saying that we're not allowed to say the word Jesus?
Well, the Fourth Circuit, the Simpson case in 2005, that issue came up in that case. That's where one of these witches from the Wiccan group.
Wiccan group.
I thought I said Jesus.
The Wiggins.
Well,
Wiggins.
That came up. The board in Chesterfield County directed in their policy to avoid invoking the name of Jesus Christ. But any citizen can come up to this podium in a 3-minute public comment and talk about Jesus for 3 minutes.
If Tim Sutton wants to pray, can he not refer to his Heavenly Father, part of the Trinity, Jesus? Can I read from the Bible as I've done in the past?
As long as you're not doing it as part of a government action.
So if we do it prior to our start of our meeting, then we're okay, right?
Well, the court has said that, and the Supreme Court said in March, the invocation must be non-sectarian with elements of the American civil religion and not be used to proselytize. And I think if you say Jesus, then you're proselytizing. But
freedom of speech. So
Jesus' prayer didn't mention Jesus. It mentioned our Father who art in heaven. So I think that this is an issue that's going to keep coming up. There are groups in our society that bring these things up from time to time. And as recently as 2005, the Fourth Circuit was hearing it. Now they've got another case in the Fourth Circuit from Forsyth County. And it really boils down to an issue of how much money they can get people to spend to defend themselves. It's going to cost about $150,000 to take that case.
They say you made the statement that they were running out of money to do all these cases.
I think we need to help bust them.
Well,
keep on doing
taxpayers' money and bust them.
In the Chesterfield County case, some of the facts in that case that I've read, the attorney for the witch, and this woman Simpson was a member of the Broom Rider, and she was proud of it. She's a member of the Broom Riders Club in Chesterfield County, Virginia, and she was a witch. She said she was a witch, but her lawyer, ACLU lawyer, said, "Hey, all you gotta do is just quit praying." Well, no, that's not acceptable. To Americans, that's not acceptable. So if we have to render what Caesar wants us to render...
Well, we may need to redo this a little.
I move that we table this and wait until we hear the appeal for the Forsyth County. And I can't reiterate enough, this should have never been put on the radar screen until we got challenged in the whole nine yards. Now we're on the radar screen.
Okay, I have a motion on the floor that we
can. I will second Tim's motion.
Second. All in favor? Okay.
Is that tabled indefinitely?
At this point, yeah. Okay, the next is the budget amendment number 120 for the Sheriff's Department.
I'd just like to know what happened to the constitutional right of freedom of speech.
Yeah.
Sir?
Well, you've got the right for private speech. Just like you stand there at that podium for 3 minutes.
I got you.
When you're in a legislative capacity, it's a government religion is what they
Commissioner, I appear before you tonight to ask that $100,000 from our federal drug seized assets be transferred over to our vehicle line item, and I'll go over why that is necessary. But I'd like to let you know, a lot of people are saying, you know, the commissioners are giving the sheriff everything he wants, and we're buying it out of federal drug seized monies. And giving an example, since October of 06 to January 31st, we've already received $778,770.14 from drug seized assets, with another $500,000 coming. In that period of time, we just hadn't got it yet. So we've been buying a lot of equipment, firearms, rifles, excess of 80 vehicles. The taxpayers hadn't had to pay for a crime scene van, all the equipment in it. Pine Street house up here that we're going to be using as office, we put right at $50,000 in that and some of our training. And what we're trying to do is replace some vehicles with high mileage. For instance, we're asking to be able to purchase 3 Fords, 1 Charger, and a 3/4-ton animal control truck, because we had one go down the embankment with ice when it was icy, and we're needing to, I'm sure you laughed.
Who was driving?
A female.
Boy, is it ice?
I was talking to her, Miss Matthew, not you. And anyway, we are asking that money be transferred for that purpose. And in return, we want to ask that a 2004 Chevrolet Impala with 118,621 miles, a 2003 Ford Crown Vic with 123,000 miles, 2004 Crown Vic with 126,000 miles, and a 2000 Ford Crown Vic with 143 miles be transferred to Alamance Community College, BLET, where our officers do training, because we do not want to put our street vehicles out there in driver's training and wind up getting wrecked, brakes ruined. Alamance Community College has their own mechanics. They fix these cars, and I would ask that be done. Also, a 2002 Dodge Intrepid with 98,000 miles be transferred to maintenance. They're wanting the vehicle in maintenance. And we also have a four-wheel drive that we're going to be taking off-road as soon as a vehicle gets here, and hopefully we'll go to Susan Osborne, whose people have to go out in the ice and snow and on children's stuff, if that's okay with the commissioners.
Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Have a second. Motion on the floor and a second. On the floor. Okay.
We also need a motion to transfer the vehicles to ACC as well.
So moved.
I got a motion. And I'll second that too.
Second, on favor to transfer the vehicles to ACC?
Aye.
Okay.
That's a question.
Thank you.
How many vehicles have we transferred over to ACC?
Probably, I'm sitting here trying to think, since I've been sheriff, probably 14, something like that.
Are they still there? Or?
Yes, ma'am, they still got them, but I'm going to tell you, some of them they fixed, they can't fix no more.
Fixing's done, huh?
You know, it is. And like I say, they use them in training our officers, defensive driving, also the pit maneuver and different things, and chases, how to react. And that's important for our officers. Well, I don't think they got there yet. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, they had every opportunity this
okay,
year.
Okay, next is our county manager reports.
Thank you, Madam Chair. With the board's approval, we'd like to present to you the interlocal agreement for the Piedmont Food and Ag Processing Center. This is between Orange, Durham, Chatham, and Alamance counties. We jointly funded a feasibility study in 2007 and applied for grants to complete the construction in 2009. And currently there is over $1.1 million worth of grants that are been associated with this project. Chatham and Orange counties have already approved of the joint use agreement, and they are now waiting on Alamance County and Durham for final approval. So this would be your wish.
Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion that we move forward with that.
Second. All in favor?
Aye. All right. Next, I just want to kind of bring some information that we discussed at the Farm Bureau luncheon a couple of weeks ago, the quarter cent sales tax discussion. Really, this came apart as far as the 2007 State Appropriations Act, which gave local governments and counties the option of either doing a quarter cent sales tax or up to 0.4% on a land transfer tax. And that 0.4% can be anywhere from 0.1, 0.2, 0.3 to 0.4. The 0.4% land transfer tax, in working with Dave Barber, we came up with numbers approximately $1 to $1.5 million. And in looking at the quarter cent sales tax, we are looking at about $2.4 million that would be additional revenue. With respect to the referendum that would occur, we would have to make that request to the Board of Elections to get it on the ballot. If we did not get it on the ballot in time, we could hold a special election. In talking with Kathy Holland, though, if we held a special wide county referendum election, that cost could run anywhere between $75,000 and $100,000. Just an FYI, the referendum that if we did put it on would be a non-binding referendum. You can put both items on the ballot, but you can only choose one. Let's say both of them passed, but you could only choose one. So that would be at the discretion of the Board of Commissioners. And again, at this point, since 2007, there have been 12 counties that have approved of the quarter cent sales tax, but no county has approved by referendum of the land transfer tax. One thing I do want to clarify, and I said this at the meeting, is originally I thought the funding was restricted to schools. It is not restricted to schools. Many communities sell it to their citizens better that it would be restricted to schools, and you can do that by resolution, but on the ballot there is no restriction. So it would be that once it was approved, then if the board wanted to allocate certain parts of it to schools, ACC, or somewhere else, that would be up to you. And again, on the memo I gave you the wording on the ballot for the land transfer tax and also the sales tax. And again, at this time, I'm not pushing either one, just trying to bring you back some additional information in case there was something else you needed from me.
One addendum or addition, where the land transfer tax is just not passing anywhere, as you said.
Right.
You said how many had passed the sales tax?
12.
But there had also been, 40-some?
40-some that have been 40 defeated.
40-some had defeated the sales
right.
tax.
Right.
So we got to keep in mind the popularity one way or the other,
right.
or lack of popularity.
Yes, sir.
Do we want to act on this tonight?
It's up to the board. You can take this. Think about it. If you would like to discuss this at a later date, we can. If you need additional information, I'll be happy to get that for you. But again, this is just options to consider. Again, any referendum would be a non-binding referendum as well.
So if we get this to the Board of Elections to put on for a referendum for this election, how soon will we have to make a decision to do that?
Let's put it on when you run.
I'd run. Hey, why not let the people decide? I mean, this is something they get to decide.
First of all, go ahead and answer his question, and you want to talk about it, we'll talk about it. Go ahead.
All counties must contact their local Board of Elections and the State Board of Elections in order to have the advisory referendum included on the ballot. If a county is unable to get the advisory referendum on the ballot, it may call for and hold a special election. The special election may not be held within the period of time beginning 30 days before and 30 days ending after the date of any other primary. So you can't have it within 30 days of the primary, if we don't make it. It depends on, I think, when the ballots would get printed. And again, I didn't ask Kathy that question. When she would have the ballots printed by. So.
Okay, just a question.
How much sales tax do we have now?
Total sales tax?
Yeah. 7.75%. So another quarter.
I think it's seven. I think it's a flat seven.
Seven, 3/4.
Either 7.2
7
or 7.
Yeah.
I thought it was 7.3.
I don't
I apologize.
Sure, in fact, I was looking at my bill from the grocery store, and it was 7.35 or 7.75.
That'd be 7.348.
Yeah. Well, here's the game people are playing with sales tax promotion. They're coming out, and you know, I can name candidates, but I won't right now. But there are candidates who want to promote a sales tax, and they say, well, you know, it evens the playing field out here. You know, it has people paying sales tax or paying tax that aren't paying property tax, blah blah blah. Okay, number one, there is sales tax out there. There's almost 8% already. And here's the little gimmick they're always saying. All right. You take a quarter of a, you said it raises how much money?
2.4 million.
All right, 2.4 million. But they never want to roll property tax back the same amount of money. They never want to do that. They want to take, well, we'll roll it back a little bit. But they don't want to roll it back the whole amount to where it's a wash. And that's true. The only time debt theory is fairly palatable is when you say, okay, so it won't be a tax increase. Is to roll property taxes back to the dime of what the sales tax increases. But that's never what they want to do, you say. And you talk about Pandora's box, in my opinion, you know, we can't handle two revenue streams, let alone adding a third one. But, you know, I won't support letting it. I can't vote for it to go to the ballot.
Well, you don't. All we got to do is put it on the ballot.
Yeah.
And it's a referendum.
Well, I'm not willing
to
let it go to the ballot with my vote.
They get to vote on what's
but
done.
We vote here whether it goes to the ballot.
Right, I agree. Right.
And I'm not willing to vote myself to let it go to the ballot.
Okay.
Myself. Because I think it's a game, I think it's a gimmick, and the public needs to have some representation that doesn't put them in the middle.
I agree. I think taxes are too high.
That's what they voted on us for, too.
Taxes are too high.
Right.
I'm not going to support
my money.
Any
taxes. Ball game's going to start in 10 minutes, Ken. Can we?
Here.
Well, we're not going to do an action on it. Is that what I'm hearing?
Can we table it? It's up to the board.
Ann has asked that we table it.
I'll make a motion that we table it.
Yeah, I'll second that.
Have a motion to second? All favor?
Aye. Uh-huh.
No.
Okay, we can do that.
All big decisions get tabled.
Okay, the next thing is the...
right, Clyde.
The permitting identification process, Mr. Honeycutt.
At the request of Commissioner Sutton, he asked that we look at the possibility of coming up with requirement to have those who are seeking a county permit to provide a valid ID to ensure that the person who is getting the permit is who they are, you know, who they say they are. In working with our county attorney, this is our recommendation to try to address those concerns, and I hope I've said it clear of your concerns.
Any questions on this? Well, I don't like it, I'll just tell you. I got a permit to do my carport. I walked in, and, you know, anybody can walk in for me and get a permit for me, and as long as you pay that $35. So, I mean, I don't understand why the people in Alamance County are going to have a – my dad didn't have a driver's license. He couldn't even have got a permit. And a lot of people don't have a driver's license, and they have to get. I just don't like the idea of having to prove who you are just to get a permit for your property, and I don't like it. So.
Well, the design of it, in my opinion, is to keep fraud down, keep people who aren't who shouldn't be able to conduct business in our county from conducting business, and you have to show proof of who you are when you put your kids in school. So forth and so on. I mean, I expect to have to show my ID when I do something. Yeah. People ask me my ID every time I, you know, I think it's common sense. You know, I'm
I'm sorry.
Well, that's my
opinion. That way. Yeah, I understand what you're saying. Okay. It does seem sort of an insult to...
To me, it's an insult to the citizens that they got... They've
been paying taxes.
They pay taxes on... They own that property or whoever sent them, and now they got to show an identification. I just think it's an insult to the citizens.
We're living in a different time. You know, that mindset is good. That mindset is good when we were all... number one, citizens of this country, when you didn't have such questionable practices going on, but you do have a segment now in society that does not play by the rules, and I think it's just common sense to know who you're dealing with. And we have a situation that provoked this that I'm not going to go into, but I think it was mishandled totally, butchered. Totally, in my opinion, as far as what should have been done. A banker would have never sat down and closed a loan with somebody without knowing who they're dealing with and have the credentials put out there. You know, it's like I told Craig over in Greensboro. I walked up to a hotel there not long ago, and it had a sign on a cash register. Get this, paying cash. If you pay cash, you have to show an ID. Why? Why? What do you think?
Don't ask me that.
Well, it sounds like there's got to be a motivation because you've got drug dealing going on, prostitution going on, and they want to have a track record of who's coming into that hotel and that you just can't pay cash and get their services.
That's fine.
So, you know.
Well, that's my opinion.
I understand. I agree.
And that can be, Tim, and it's not totally bad because, like, a lot of things you do have to have a license to go in there. Yeah. My contractor's license doesn't have my picture on it, but if I went over there, I would expect to be able to take my printed contractor's license and get a permit. The state of North Carolina recognizes that as my license. I didn't, you know, I had to show an ID to get that.
Yeah. You have to fill out a form, first of all, and before you can even get a permit. So,
right.
I mean, you don't.
And as a contractor, state of North Carolina required, I did have an ID to get that license.
When somebody gets a gun permit at the sheriff's department, do we not ID them?
Yes, sir. You got a social security number, their driver's license, and somebody has to vouch for them.
And you get fingerprinted. That's a little different from a building permit. Now.
Oh, it is.
A permit is a permit.
I don't know. I think I really have to think about agree with Tim because you have a lot more people coming in here claiming to be Joe Snow, and you don't know that that's really who they are, and maybe some kind of identification is in order.
Well, it could be a liability factor.
Absolutely.
Can you make that a motion?
Yeah, I thought what? Or
you just think that's...
All right, I move that we adopt this policy as we're speaking.
On favor?
Aye.
I'm opposed.
Okay. Madam Chair, there's a couple things I do want to mention. Please don't forget April 8th, 8:30 in the morning, when we have the ribbon cutting for the civil courts building. If you could come, I don't think we'll have coffee or donuts, but we'd still
love to. Coffee.
There's a coffee across the street. We'll
bring your own.
But would love for you to come. And then also at our April 19th meeting, number one, thank you for the work that y'all did today with respect to the budget workshop. I think you gave us some very clear direction, and we will make a presentation back to you with our staff's recommendations trying to meet your concerns at that meeting on the 19th.
Okay, the next thing is our consent agenda. And we have to approve that. Do I hear any questions on that? I did swear in the Board of Equalization today at 2 o'clock.
They're equalized.
Does anybody have any questions on that?
No.
If not, do I hear a motion? We accept the consent agenda.
So moved.
Have a motion on the floor.
Second.
And a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Any comments from commissioners?
Yeah, I'd like to make one. I did take the proposal down to the southern end of the county this last weekend and made that presentation. They did a very good job in what they did. The people down there were thrilled to death. it wasn't just Pat Bailey standing here, and I know some of you are surprised because she's worked so hard to get the recognition down there. And it wasn't just 400 people that showed up. I would say it was upwards of 500 or more that showed up out there. And they were so proud of that plaque that was down there. County did a great job in recognizing these people that have worked so hard. They do a great job. And I want to thank everybody involved in doing that. Thank you.
Pat Bailey called the radio show and talked all about you doing that, too.
Did she? Now, see, she would have talked about you doing it if you did that.
Any other comments? Any other commissioner comments?
That was enough right there.
Any announcements?
No more.
If we don't have any announcements, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.